On the morning of December 7, 1909, Captain Robert McLeod and his crew of 30 men were preparing the car ferry SS Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 for its daily trip to Port Stanley, Ontario, Canada. This would be the ship's final run of the season on Lake Erie before she goes into winter layup. As the M&B No. 2 departed into a winter storm from Conneaut Harbor at 10:43 a.m., she would never reach her destination as the ship sank with all hands. No one knows exactly how she sank or where the wreck is located. This ensued one of the greatest mysteries on Lake Erie that has not been solved to this day 112 years later. Experts do know, however, the main culprit which contributed to her sinking, a fatal design choice omitted from when the ship was built 4 years earlier. This is the story of the SS Marquette and Bessemer No. 2. In 1894, the Pittsburgh-Chenango and Lake Erie Railroad initiated a study to prove the feasibility of starting a railcar ferry service across Lake Erie between Conneaut and Port Dover, Ontario, Canada. They wanted to interchange various commodities, mostly consisting of coal, with the Grand Trunk Railway in Port Dover. This led to the creation of a subsidiary called the United States and Ontario Steam Navigation Company in 1895. The name later changed in 1903 when the Pittsburgh-Chenango and Lake Erie successor, the Bessemer and Lake Erie, partnered with the Pier Marquette Railway. Called the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company, the ferry line's interchange location was changed from Port Dover to Rondeau and Port Stanley, Ontario. The car ferry line began operations on August 22, 1895 by a grand passenger excursion from Conneaut to Port Dover on the company's first ship named Chenango No. 1. It, along with its sister ship, the Chenango No. 2, were built side by side at the Craig Shipbuilding Company in Toledo, Ohio. Both had wooden hulls measuring 300 feet in overall length, a beam of 53 feet, and a depth of 19 feet. Not only could they carry 26 rail cars, but they also had accommodations for a few passengers, though freight made up the bulk of their traffic 99% of the time. On October 1, 1895, Captain Robert McLeod, a native of Kincardine, Ontario, was appointed as master of the Chenango No. 1. McLeod was 33 years old and had seven brothers, four of whom were also sailors on the Great Lakes. Robert had been sailing since 1874 and worked his way up through the ranks, starting as a cook to becoming a captain in 1892. He was a well-respected and experienced mariner with many successful seasons in the books. While the car ferry service was profitable in the beginning, it wasn't completely successful due to low traffic and the Chenangos being underpowered. They couldn't keep regular service during severe weather in the fall and winter months and repeatedly got stuck in ice. As a result, Chenango No. 2 was sold in 1898 to the Detroit Grand Rapids and Western Railroad Company, leaving only the Chenango No. 1. Chenango No. 1 would ply Lake Erie until tragedy struck on the morning of March 11, 1904, when she caught fire while stuck in the ice near Conneaut's breakwater. An oil can in the ship's engine room ignited, causing an explosion which killed fireman Charles McCarter. The fire was unable to be extinguished, leaving Captain John C. McLeod and five other crew members with no choice but to abandon the ship. It nearly burned down to its waterline and was deemed a total loss valued at $230,000. With Chenango No. 1 destroyed, the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company needed a new ship quickly. One that was larger, more powerful, and able to take a beating during rough weather. Their choice was the Logan boat, a design named after its creator, Robert Logan, a naval architect. Logan's design became the world's first steel train ferry when it was introduced in 1896 with the construction of the Pier Marquette 15. The Pier Marquette Railway had five other similar ships constructed with this design for their car ferry service on Lake Michigan. The Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 was built by the American Shipbuilding Company at their dock in Cleveland, Ohio. Assigned as hull number 428, her steel hull measured 350 feet in overall length, a beam of 54 feet, and a depth of 19 feet. M&B No. 2 was launched on September 12, 1905, and entered into service the next month. Captain Robert McLeod was appointed as her master in March 1907. McLeod had also been captain on MMB No. 2's older fleet mate, built in 1903, named the Marquette and Bessemer No. 1. Not only was she smaller, being 255 feet in overall length, her design was much different compared to her counterpart. Running the length of her spar deck between the aft cabin were two removable railroad tracks. Coal hoppers would be loaded through her stern and then emptied through their bottom doors into the ship's holds. MMB No. 1 ran exclusively between Conneaut and Rondeau, while MMB No. 2 operated to Port Stanley. With a top speed of 12 knots, she could complete the 58-mile run to Port Stanley in about 5 hours. Powering her two propellers were triple expansion steam engines that could output 2,400 horsepower, allowing her to carry 30 rail cars on 4 tracks inside her car deck. When loading or unloading, her stern was backed up to the dock and the rail cars were unchained and pulled out by a locomotive. Empties were then run back to Conneaut. One thing the MMB No. 2 did not have was a stern gate, as did the other Logan boats, leaving them vulnerable to waves washing into their car deck. In the event of a storm, captains were instructed to head bow first into the waves to prevent them from entering the stern and flooding the car deck, while in theory, it doesn't work. During a storm in November 1909, Captain Robert McLeod complained to the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company that the MMB No. 2 had almost foundered. He kept her heading directly into the heavy waters as instructed by the company. However, with her stern sinking into the trough of the waves, water rushed into her car deck with tremendous force and volume. MMB No. 2's entire crew were shaken up after this event and felt the ship wasn't safe. Several were even contemplating quitting after her last run of the season. The Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company had promised Captain Robert McLeod a stern gate would be installed in the ship during the off-season after the ship's last run. That day just so happened to be December 7, 1909. On the morning of Tuesday, December 7, 1909, the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 was preparing to leave Conneaut for Port Stanley with a load of 26 rail cars carrying coal, 3 carrying steel beams, and 1 carrying iron castings. Serving as Captain Robert McLeod's first mate is his brother John, who also held a captain's license. The weather this morning was terrible and would only get worse as the day went on. Gale force winds were blowing steadily at 50 miles per hour, while heavy lake effect snow made visibility extremely low. This storm lasted about a week and would claim 3 other vessels. Just as the MMB No. 2 was about to depart Conneaut around 8 a.m., the wind caused an oar boat's hawsers to break loose as it was being tied up for the winter. The boat blocked the channel, preventing MMB No. 2 from leaving. 2 tugboats were dispatched to secure the oar boat back to the dock and to clear the channel. After the 2-hour delay, MMB No. 2 cast off at approximately 10:25 a.m. and started making its way out of Conneaut Harbor. Running late due to the weather is Albert J. Weiss, treasurer of the Keystone Fishing Company of Erie, Pennsylvania. He was the ship's sole passenger and hopped aboard at the last second as the ship's stern pulled away from the dock. Weiss was on his way to Canada to purchase a Canadian fishing firm on behalf of his company. He was carrying between $30,000 and $50,000 worth of cash to complete the transaction. At 10:43 a.m., MMB No. 2 was finally out of the harbor, passing the Conneaut breakwall to continue its 5-hour run to Port Stanley. At the same time, a commercial fishing tug, owned by Frank Snyder, passes MMB No. 2 while heading into the harbor. Snyder claims that when they passed each other, Captain Robert McLeod tried to shout something at him through a megaphone. He couldn't make out what he said due to the worsening storm. Southwest gale force winds had increased from 50 to 70 miles per hour, while by mid-afternoon, the temperature dropped from 40 to 10 degrees. From this moment forward, no one will ever know exactly what takes place on board the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2. Neither she or her fleet mate had wireless equipment on board to call for help. Sadly, negotiations had been pending to put wireless telegraphs on both ships several months before this run. At dusk between 5 and 6 o'clock, a Canadian customs official spots MMB No. 2's lights and profile approaching Port Stanley's breakwall. At the last second, MNB No. 2 turns to port heading west away from Port Stanley. It is suspected Captain McLeod couldn't safely navigate his ship in the extreme waves into Port Stanley's narrow harbor because of the inadequate marine lights and tried to make for Rondeau. If McLeod did indeed intend to head to Rondeau, he wouldn't have been able to make port here either. The Marquette and Bessemer No. 1, which left Conneaut at 6 a.m., had to divert from Rondeau to Port Stanley. Now this is where things get confusing, as there are conflicting hearings and sightings of MNB No. 2. Around midnight on Wednesday, December 8th, a captain and engineer of a steamship anchored off Conneaut claimed to have seen MNB No. 2 try to enter Conneaut Harbor but couldn't make it and continued on an easterly course. Two Conneaut dock employees reported hearing MNB No. 2 blowing a distress signal on its whistle multiple times between 1:30 and 2 o'clock on Wednesday morning. About 3 a.m., the same Canadian customs official who spotted MNB No. 2 Tuesday evening hears her distress whistle off Port Stanley, including a nearby resident. About 30 minutes after their report, a man in Port Bruce, which is just east of Port Stanley, claims to have also heard her distress whistle. The last reported sightings of MNB No. 2 were off the shore in Fairview Township, Pennsylvania. One woman who lives near the shore claims to have seen her navigation lights displaying green, red, and white, meaning the ship was heading directly towards shore. She put up a light to warn the ship it was coming too close to shore. Shortly afterwards, the woman claims to have only seen the ship's stern white light, meaning it turned away. As you can see, MNB No. 2 was spotted in various places on either side of the lake in a brief period. Remember, her trip to or from Port Stanley takes approximately 5 hours. There is no way she could have been in both places around the same time. Experts have called to question the credibility of some of these reports. Since the Canadian customs official and Conneaut dock employees saw her every day, I feel as though their statements are the most credible of the bunch. Word about the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2's disappearance quickly spread the following day. Some of the crew's family members became increasingly worried and started contacting the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company. They didn't see the need for concern so quickly because in the past, both the MNB No. 2 and Chenango No. 1 had been overdue for days or weeks at a time. During those times, they were either stuck in ice or took refuge in port somewhere, which is what the company thought happened in this case. Their positive thinking quickly diminished as the Marquette and Bessemer No. 1 was dispatched to search both sides of the lake with no signs of her fleetmate. All hope was lost on Friday morning, December 10, 1909, when a wireless message was received at Cleveland, Ohio from Captain Benson Fox of the bulk freighter W.B. Davok. The message reads, "The Davok has been running through light wreckage for about 15 miles above Long Point, Ontario. Abreast of Long Point, we passed a metallic yawl boat painted green and full of water. We could not make out the name." That lifeboat exactly matched the description of the four lifeboats the MNB No. 2 carried. Though instead of searching the area for more evidence, the Davok continued to its destination at Detroit after it failed to spot any occupants. This move was widely criticized in the newspapers. Families of the lost crew members were so grief-stricken that they would not admit the ship sank even after the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company gave up hope. In response, Pennsylvania Fish Commission's tugboat, the Commodore Perry, was dispatched from Erie, Pennsylvania to give confirmation by picking up pieces of wreckage. On Saturday, December 11th, the Commodore Perry ran across a debris field that included hatches, chairs, tables, and wood shatters, but no lifeboat or bodies. After almost 48 hours of searching on Lake Erie, on December 12th, Captain Jeremiah Driscoll spotted a dark blotch against the dreary gray of the lake and sky 15 miles north of Erie. While looking through binoculars, it was made out to be a green 10-man lifeboat riding low in the water. As they steamed towards the lifeboat, the lookout spotted words on its bow reading Marquette and Bessemer No. 2. Below it was the number 4, signifying they found the ship's number 4 lifeboat. When they got closer, Driscoll noticed there were occupants inside. It became a gruesome sight for him and his crew as the 9 men inside the waterlogged boat were frozen to death. The heavy sea prevented Driscoll and his crew from boarding the boat to recover their bodies. After quick thinking, they ran a rope from the Perry through a ring on the lifeboat near its bow. A pike pole was used to keep the boat in place as the Perry towed it carefully back to Erie, Pennsylvania. While on the way, the Perry encountered another tugboat also searching for wreckage. The tugboat went ahead of the Perry to relay the news of their discovery back at Erie. With the Perry's flag at half-mast, she steamed into the harbor at 4:20 p.m., awaited by a crowd of 1,000 people and four ambulances. To remove the frozen men from the boat, they were thawed by a steam line rigged from the Pennsylvania Naval Militia's USS Wolverine docked in the adjacent slip. Four of the nine men were sitting on seats, while another four were found draped over the last man, appearing as if they were trying to warm him. A full wardrobe was also found lying on the floor of the bow end of the boat, suggesting there may have been a tenth man. Investigators think this man has suffered from the effects of severe hypothermia, causing paradoxical undressing, and had jumped ship. After being taken to the coroner, the nine Marquette and Bessemer crew members were identified. Their names are as follows: Coal Pastor Charles Allen, Oiler John Hart, Coal Pastors Ray Hines and William Ray, Fireman Joe Shank, Steward George Smith, Waiter John Soros, Fireman Thomas Steele, and Second Cook Harry Thomas. George Smith had been the only man wearing an overcoat, while the rest were dressed in overalls and jumpers, suggesting they had to abandon ship in a moment's notice. Investigators also found two large knives and a meat cleaver on the body of George Smith. In the following months, more wreckage and bodies from the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 began showing up on both the Canadian and American sides of Lake Erie. The ship's No. 2 lifeboat washed ashore 8 miles east of Port Burwell, Canada. Nearby, the flotation tanks belonging to another lifeboat were also found. The last lifeboat was discovered in the spring of 1910, broken in two on a breakwall in Buffalo, New York. On April 6, 1910, Niagara Falls Power Company workers clearing ice away from the powerhouse intake were in shock when they found the body of First Mate John McLeod. He was kept afloat by a life preserver marked with the ship's name. In his pockets were a bundle of documents, $125 in cash, and a pocket watch stopped at 12:25 p.m. On October 5th, men patrolling the beach at Long Point discovered the body of Captain Robert McLeod. Two slash marks noted by the coroner on Captain McLeod's body sparked a controversial claim made in Dwight Boyer's Ghost Ships of the Great Lakes book published in 1968. Boyer suggested a mutiny had taken place and that these slash marks were from the knives found on the body of Steward George Smith. There is, however, no evidence that backs up his remark. One author later rebutted his claim, suggesting these slash wounds could have come from the wreck or something in the lake, considering he had been found nearly 10 months after the ship sinking. The men patrolling the beach at Long Point also later found the body of wheelsman William Wilson. In addition to him, Chief Engineer Eugene Wood and Coal Pastor Patrick Keefe were recovered in 1910. None of the bodies of the other 17 crew members or the sole passenger has ever been located. The loss of the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 was valued at $350,000 and the cargo at upwards of $40,000. There was never a formal investigation held to determine the cause of the sinking due to two issues: no witness accounts and not being able to locate the wreck. For a while, the company was offering a $500 reward that was later increased to $5,000 for information leading to the wreck's precise location. Most mariners and researchers have speculated the ship sank somewhere off Long Point, Ontario, but with each search of the area, nothing has turned up. Even though there is no official report, there are two probable causes that led to the ship's sinking. The first was made shortly after its disappearance by Alfred Leslie, general manager of the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company. He told newspapers, "It is my opinion that the heavy seas broke the key which held the cars in place, and weighted heavily with coal, they raced to the stern of the boat. She probably turned turtle and sank without a minute's warning." This theory is borne out by the fact that the men were splendidly drilled and only a short time would have sufficed for them to launch the boats, which, with proper handling, would ride in a storm. The second theory focuses on the ship's lack of a stern gate. Other ship captains braving the storm reported waves exceeding 15 feet and heavy ice accumulating on their vessels. Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 more than likely had ice on it, making the ship hard to maneuver its open stern away from the waves. Water probably rushed into the MMB No. 2's car deck and flooded the engine room through two coal bunkering hatches that were always kept open. MMB No. 2 nearly foundered this way in a storm about a month before its sinking. Yet, the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2's replacement vessel, launched in 1910, had a stern gate. It was built to the same plans by the American Shipbuilding Company and was also named the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2. Many of the family members felt the ship should have been named No. 3 instead, and that the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company was trying to cover up the disaster. When the ship's story gained popularity in the 1950s, people mistook the replacement vessel for the original ship. One of the easiest ways to differentiate between the two is the replacement Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 had an enclosed flying bridge. Ironically, on the same day Captain Robert McLeod's body was found on Long Point, the replacement Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 made its maiden voyage. The ship continued car ferry service until the Marquette and Bessemer Dock and Navigation Company ceased operations on August 25, 1932. After passing through several owners over the years, it was cut down into a pulpwood barge and scrapped in 1997. To think, if one of the many variables were changed, things could have played out differently for the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2. If her original departure time from Conneaut had not been delayed, would she have made Port Stanley in time before dusk? Even then, if she did leave late, and there had been proper marine lights at Port Stanley, would Captain McLeod have made port safely? If the ship's wireless equipment installation wasn't delayed, it's quite possible some lives could have been saved. Maybe her final resting place could have also been located by now. Of course, if the ship had a stern gate, chances are none of this would have ever happened. Hopefully one day, the Marquette and Bessemer No. 2 will give up her location, giving some closure to descendants of the crew. What do you think happened to the ship, and where her wreck might be located? Let me know below in the comments. If you found this video interesting, consider subscribing to Railroad Street for more videos just like this. Thanks for watching, everyone.